deep, deep karmic connections with Tibet. Alright? When I was a child, my parents took me to Pachmadi. And there I saw a Buddhist monk from Burma. I was younger than my grandson, who is now 10. I was, I think, 8 or 9. And when I saw him, I don't know what happened to him, to me. I started following him like he was the Pied Piper of Hamelin. You know, you heard that story, the Pied Piper of Hamelin. So my parents were amazed. Where are you going? Where did you vanish? So I was just stuck with him and talking to him like, you know, I had known him forever. When I went to the National Defense Academy, by that time I had started reading a lot on Tibetan Buddhism. Some of the best authors, Lama, Garika, Govinda, you know, and Giuseppe Tucci, he's an Italian writer on Tibet religion. I was fascinated, you know. And when I went to the NDA, we had to learn a foreign language. So they asked me, what foreign language do you want to learn? I said, Tibetan. You see? And our Tibetan teacher was Yigma Pa Lama, Lama Thinle Dorji Bhutia. He was my Begelda. You know? I remember him with a lot of respect. So, you know, I met him and there was one of the functions. You could do that Tibetan language from the third term. I was then in the second term. And I just saw him. He was, you know, tall, kampa, you know, 6+. So I just went up to him and I started talking to him. Sir, I want to learn Tibetan. He was very happy. He said, why don't you come over home? I said, I'm very interested in Tibetan religion. I've done this. He says, you come over home. So I went to his house, you know. And the moment I reached his house, I was not even entered. I felt the scent, a strong scent of incense. Wo dhoop bolta hai na? Strong scent of incense. So I looked around at what was burning. You know, acrid scent of incense. So I looked around, nothing was burning. I went to his house and he had not burned that incense. And very amazingly, every time I go to anywhere close to a Tibetan settlement colony, I start getting that scent. Very strange scent, you know. So I used to wonder, what is this scent? Then I was posted to Sikkim, and I was sent on a long-range patrol. Deep back of beyond, there is a Kolang Gompa, where the skull of the third Chogyal is kept embalmed in gold. Very Kishangla pass, I had to cross down there. Very tough march. So when I was, we slept the night on the floor in that yak hut, you know, in our sleeping bags, and the morning I woke up, I got that scent. I just got up and I said, ye kya hai? So that monk said, ye dekho. You know, it is that rhododendron, scented rhododendron, they burn as dhoop in the monasteries, in the gompas. Tibetan, strong, acrid sense it has. And this is a memory that has come to me over the lives. In dreams, I used to see the chortens, the prayer flags, you know, and the connection has continued. I want to tell you about the invasion of your and enslavement of your country. 10th of June, 1950, the Second Field Army of the People's Liberation Army of China under Field Marshal Liu Bocheng. He was called the One-Eyed Dragon, one of the best generals to come out from the Civil War. He led the Second Field Army in the attack on Tibet. Four divisions attacked Tibet from the side of the east, right? And they were given a tough fight. But after all, what did the Tibetan army have? They just had muskets. How will you fight with a modern army with artillery, tanks, guns, everything, with muskets? So quite obviously, everything got over. The Chinese occupied Lhasa. And then, of course, the first revolt started in 1953. Amrut Shah Pandachang. You heard this name? Andruchang, Pandachang, these were Khampa, great Khampa leaders. So that is the time they started this organization, came up in 56, Chushi Gandru. Yeah? Chushi Gandru, you know, six mountains, four rivers. That is the ancient name of Tibet. So they started this resistance. And till 1959, they put up a very stiff fight. You see, and then they got to know that the Chinese were going to do harm to His Holiness the Dalai Lama. It is the Khampa guerrillas of Raga Panda Chang and Andru Chang who then got His Holiness out. And by 1959, he was safe in India. And he was given refuge. The struggle continued in Lokha. Lokha area, that is the area north of Bhutan and Sikkim, where the dense forests. And the Chinese brought in additional forces, they were ruthless. The Ritan monastery was bombed. It was attacked by tanks, the monks fought. You know, they were forced to fight. They put up very stiff resistance. For quite some time, the resistance continued in Lokha. Then, of course, the resistance had, because of the pressure of the Chinese, had to shift. The resistance movement shifted to Mastang. Mastang is a little kingdom in Nepal. That is where the Khampas made their base. Until 1974, they were fighting. In 1974, they were fighting. Well, you know, the Americans, Richard Nixon, made that outreach to China and this and that, and you know, we lost that battle, more or less, the first phase finished. It's not over. I've come here to tell you, it's not over yet. It will not be. If Tibet is free, it will have to be free. Because of the simple fact that the Chinese cannot be trusted with the roof of the world, with the water tower of the world. 10 major rivers of Asia, 9 originate from Tibet, which includes our own Indus, our Brahmaputra, and a whole lot of other rivers, Salwi, Mekong, etc., etc. This is the water tower of the world. And do you know something? That the resource that is depleting, that is diminishing rapidly and alarmingly, you know, is what? Fresh waters. Just like we today have wars for oil. America invaded Iraq for what? For oil. You see, and most of the wars, you know, even the invasion of Egypt and the others, the Gaza operations, were all for what? For oil. In this century, the wars will very soon be for water. Water wars. And as Dalmala was telling you all, he's already building 8 dams on the Brahmaputra River. Right? And especially at the bend of the Brahmaputra, they are building up these major, major dams. They say they are run of the water. But the fact is, they will cause a problem. You see, 40% of the water of the Brahmaputra comes from Tibet. 60% comes from our own rivers. But the fact is, the Tibetan waters that come from the Tibet side are crucial for sustaining these rivers in winter. Right? And if this winter flow diminishes, there will be disaster. Disaster in Assam. Disaster in all the lower province. So, you know, however peaceful we may be, however pacific ahimsa we may have, there will be a time at which you will be forced to fight. And let me also state, I have studied the Tibetan religion enough to state, there are the powers of Buddhism. There is the Vikral rule, you understand? the Ugra roop of even the Tibetan gods, even the Buddhist gods. Heroka, have you heard that name? They are the protectors of Buddhism. And they will rise. They will rise. And you, I'm afraid, a lot of you will have to pay the price. Because freedom comes with a price. All that I want to tell you is, I don't think you are alone. You are not alone. We can't afford it. You know, we can't afford to have somebody stopping our water, fresh water. You don't drink water, you can't live more than a day or two. You start fainting after that. So there is a kind of a destiny which is impelling us into a very problematic era, whether we want to or we don't want to. You will be forced to fight. You will be forced to fight. And that is where I see hope. In that coming Mahabharata, I see hope. You know, in the Indian tradition, at the end of every yuga, there is a Mahabharata. There was a Mahabharata in the Treta Yuga. This is the Kali Yuga, and it is supposed to be ending. Maybe that will be the battle that will end the demonic forces. Why demonic? We have nothing against the Chinese people. We have everything against the communist government in China. We have everything against the communist government in China, which has enslaved its own people. The Dalai Lama was saying, in every house there is a bug. In your bathroom they are watching what you are doing, what you are saying, whom you are talking against. Freedom of speech, my foot. My foot, freedom of speech. You know, you are a surveillance Orwellian state. The biggest abomination in the whole world, a threat to free societies all over the world. And the problem is that till such time as you do what you like in your own country, you are now spreading. You are trying to threaten small countries like Vietnam, small countries like Indonesia, Malaysia. You see, all these little countries, every day they fly their planes against Taiwan in some kind of a major demonstration of power. They are getting aggressive, expansive. Very, very aggressive. They have very methodically built up their economic power. They are now converting that economic power into military power. That is that book I wrote on the military power of China. If you have to fight somebody, you better know. You know, if you know yourself, Sun Tzu said, if you know yourself, but not the enemy, for every battle that you fight, you will lose another. If you know neither yourself nor the enemy, you are a fool and you deserve defeat. You have to know your enemy. You have to know what you are up against. That is why we did this study, because study is extremely important. Understanding who you are against is extremely important. And therefore, we find China today has got a 350 ship navy, bigger than the Navy of the United States. Bigger than the Navy of the United States, and that's at 280 ships. So you can see the kind of way in which they are expanding. That doesn't mean we have to get frightened. That doesn't mean our legs should shake. Alright? Let me tell you a thing or two about the country you are now in. We have today the largest population in the world. Alright? 1.4 billion people, right? 1.4 billion people. We are more than the population of China, which is what they used to pride themselves up against. They are the largest population in the world. Wrong. Today, India is the largest population in the world. Where the Chinese population is aging, most of them are now getting above 60, right? We have the youngest population in the world. 50% of Indians are below the age of 25. So if we have to raise an army, we can raise the biggest army in the world. And already we have the second largest army, we have the fourth largest air force, and we have the fifth largest navy. We don't like to go around looking for fights. But we don't like being pushed. We don't like being pushed. When we are living peacefully, we expect you to live in peace. And let us in peace. But we have friends on our borders, the Chinese to the north, the Pakistanis to our west, who don't want to let you live in peace. जिसको हिंदी में बोलते हैं ना चैन से जिएंगे ना चैन से जीने देंगे, ठीक है सर? एंड नाउ द थ्रेट एनवेलप टू इंडिया इज राइजिंग. पाकिस्तान विद वी वर क्वाइट सरप्राइज्ड विद अमेरिकन हेल्प, अ लॉट ऑफ अमेरिकन हेल्प हैज टेकन ओवर अफगानिस्तान. दे हैव इंस्टॉल्ड इन पावर देयर अ माफिया, अ ड्रग माफिया, a criminal mafia of terrorists. Half their ministers are designated global terrorists. That's what they have installed in power there. So in the next war, you could expect some Taliban also to join up. Then we have a country called Turkey. Erdogan, he thinks he's the next Khalifa of the world. He wants to help Pakistan. He wants to send 3,000 Syrian terrorist fighters to fight in J&K. You look after your bloody country. What business have you in J&K? Mare baap ka theka hai? Mara baap ka raaj hai ki you want to fight in this thing? So, you know, there was one chap trying to talk with me. You know, one Turkish gentleman was engaging with me on the Twitter and on the Facebook and, you know, trying to discuss things with me. I just told him, I said, I hope you remember that India is a nuclear power. And I hope you remember that if you push us beyond our point, Ankara may go up in holy smoke. You know, your capital city may not be there. And as far as our Chinese friends are concerned, we have the Agni 5. And they were very upset when we recently tested the Agni 5. It has got Beijing in its range. I want to tell you certain things. Evil has to be fought against. Right? And what is evil? I'll tell you what is evil. The Chinese army hasn't fought a war for the last 41 years. Did you know that? The Chinese army has not fought a war since the last 41 years. When they attacked us in 62, they were combat hardened. For 30 years they had been fighting the Chinese civil war with the Kuomintang. Then they had fought the Americans in Korea. Then they had been fighting the Khampas in Tibet. So they were well-trained combat hardened. And that time we were on our ahimsa binge. You know, we were being that if somebody hits you on one cheek, turn the other cheek. You know what is the Chinese saying? If a man slaps you once, it is his mistake. Because you'll give him such a thrashing that he'll be sorry he ever raised his hand against you. But if he slaps you twice, then it is your mistake. I'm sorry, we have to get to that. You have to dekhe apne aap ko badalna hota hai jaisa dushman hai. If he is noble, you be noble. If he is decent, you be decent. But if he's not, you just become his mirror and give it back to him exactly tit for tat. We had not been going around fingering China, but we find that the Chinese have again started. Right? And like I said, the problem is they haven't fought a war for 41 years. The last war that they fought was with Vietnam. And Vietnam bashed them black and blue. The Vietnamese are some of the best fighters in the world. They have thrashed the French. They have thrashed the Americans. They have thrashed the Chinese. Small nation. Small nation. But brave. Extremely brave. You also have, you know, you may not be that aware, very strong fighting tradition. You know, Tibet was a great military power once. Tibet was a great military power once. Your Khampas, your Amdos, the terrific fighting material. Right? So the fact of the matter is, the Chinese haven't fought a war for 41 years. they have a single child policy. Understand this. By order, you know, because everything the top leader has, maximum leader has spoken. Nobody will have more than one child. Bus, that's it. Cut. You see? So they had this one child policy. Because of that, today they have an aging population. In the military, they say a one child, single child should never be sent to the military. Because he is the only child of his parents. If he is lost, I mean, the parents are finished. They don't want to lose him. He doesn't want to die. So we have this, you know, generation of princelings in China. They don't want to fight. Let me be very blunt. They don't want to fight. When they are sent into the military and they are, you know, put through tough military training, then they swallow red ink and say, "Mera khoon aa raha hai. Please, I want to rest." This is the fact. This is the fact. So how does this country decide to fight? They know that if it really comes to a fight, in Galwan, you know, our Khalsas and our Jats, they're huge fellows. We had the hand-to-hand combat with these guys, they're pretty short. They got thrashed. They got thrummed. I spoke to the Northern Army commander, 68 of them stretchers we had seen being taken out. We lost 20, fine, because we were taken by surprise. Because they were on the height, they started throwing the pelting, the stones and all that. And they came with those baseball bats, with those wire, barbed wire wound around that and all that. But then once the fight started, our boys gave it back. They lost about 68. The Chinese reports are saying over 100. The Russians said 45. And the Americans said 35. I mean, there are various reports. But let me assure you, they have lost something like close to 100. And thereafter, we have seen a marked, disinclination to tangle. Disinclination to tangle. But then how did they decide to hit back? They hit back against the world with COVID. The way you fight shows us who you are. Aapka ladne ka tarika dikhata hai, aap kis kisam ke insaan. You see, a good guy will never hit you from the back. If he's a good, brave guy, come here. Come on, come, let's see how tough you are. He'll fight you face to face. But that devious chap will come from behind and poke you with this and that, get 20 chaps. It shows the kind of a muck that he is. And the way China infected the whole world, 250 million people have been infected globally. Over 2 million are dead. Sorry, not 2. 5 million are dead. The 5 million mark was just crossed a few days back. And you think it's a natural epidemic? No, sir. There is the Wuhan Institute of Virology. There is a Wuhan Institute of Virology where the people in charge are two Chinese major generals. Xi Zhengli and Chen Wei. Major General Chen Wei. The All India Institute of Medical Sciences is not run by military officers. The very fact that it is being run by military officers shows it is that. And now adequate proof has come out that this Wuhan virus was made in the laboratory and then spread to the whole world. And they have got 1,500 such viruses stored in the Wuhan Institute of Virology. They are going to fight you with viruses. They are going to make the whole bloody world miserable. So now somewhere the world has to say, enough is enough. We will have to get together and put a stop to this kind of nonsense. Firstly, you stop the waters of the world. Now you try and make the world sick. The only way of finding is to spread coronavirus, bat virus. That lady is called the bat woman of China. Is this the way you fight? This is evil. Please understand. This is evil, and in a soldier's book, evil must be fought against. We must raise our voice, and we must stand up and fight. No cowardice then, no nothing. He who fights and runs away may live to fight another day. Nay, we will fight and we will die for what is right. And what die? We will kill you first. we will kill you first because you are evil. And evil must be fought against. There is no compromise with evil. हमारा बोलते हैं जो पाप करता है सो पाप करता है, जो पाप सहता है उससे भी बड़ा पाप करता है. So I think it's about time for the world to tell China enough is enough. And that I see happening all over the globe. People are getting fed up. Australia, Japan, India, America, they're all getting together. UK, France, they're all getting together. I think we've taken enough of your bullying. We've taken enough of your bullying. You bullied the world enough, and if you think you can cross certain lines, then there will be costs. There will be costs. And if the world decides to inflict those costs, then I see hope for Tibet. I'm not selling you pipe dreams. आपको सपने नहीं बेच रहा. मैं आपको बता रहा हूं कि शायद आपका समय आ रहा है. Practical. Soldiers talk practical stuff. That which they see, as per my analysis, I see this happening because the world is getting sick and tired of the shenanigans of China. And China itself has weaknesses. It's not 10 feet tall. It's not 10 feet tall. It can't be taken on. And let me tell you, if there is one country in Asia which can stand up to China, it is India. It is India. We have gotten over our Ahimsa Parmo Dharma phase, because of which we suffered in 62. It is not the same army. If the Chinese take it to the same army of 62, they got a serious reality check coming. Since 62, our army has fought one war after another. We fought in 65, we fought in 71, we broke Pakistan in two, and I was a part of that campaign in Bangladesh. 13 days, we broke Pakistan in two. 93,000 prisoners of war with their hands up like this in Dhaka. We freed, we created a new nation state with the force of arms. We created Bangladesh. And we came out. Unlike the Chinese, we didn't grab down and try and change the population ratio there, do genocide there. We came out. We said, we help you to get free. That's a noble duty. Freedom is the highest thing. If I can help you to be free, it's my duty to help you to be free. Thereafter, I don't need the land of Tibet. I don't need anything. We are here. We are happy. As long as you let us come to Kailash Mansarovar for pilgrimage. Ladies and gentlemen, I have given you this rational analysis as to why I think the time is coming for you to hope in a concrete fashion for your freedom. And for that, I would be very happy. You know, your boys of the Vikas, the Tibetan soldiers of the Vikas, they surprised the daylights out of the Chinese army by occupying the Kailash Range. They were also rushing for it. We were there first. And then they tried to do that pushing, shoving. They just fired. First shot in the air, next is on your chest. The Chinese went well. Our boys of Vikas have done a terrific job. I've seen the Pidja fighting in Siachen Glacier, in Ladakh, in all these places. He's one of the toughest soldiers that I've seen in mountain warfare. There is nobody to beat you. Your genetics gave you lungs which can breathe at 15,000. Everybody else on the plane has to acclimatize for 15 days to fight in Tibet. You are born ready to fight. And maybe the time has come when more and more of your young boys and girls can join and contribute to the freedom of your country. We are not looking for wars. We are not looking for battles. We are not provoking people, but we don't like being pushed. We don't like our water being taken. We don't like our territory being nibbled upon 24/7. So somewhere or something, it will have to be given back. We don't like to be made sick. We don't like our relations dying of COVID. So if China has to fight, you may fight the proper way. Then let's see how good you are. Let's see how good you are. All right? And let me tell you, they are not 10 feet tall. They are single child family soldiers. Traditionally, no soldier from a single child family fights. No soldier fights. So on that optimistic note, I thank you for inviting me over. I have deep karmic connections with you all, and possibly I have been a Tibetan in many lives. So I'm just paying back my gratitude to my own people of different births. That is what we believe in. And I'm sure, Rangwang, we will get that. My Tibetan is not so fluent, and they say Sacha Rere. Sacha Rere Lama Sacha Rere Ke Rere. Lama Rere Choy Rere. So my K is not that pure. A lot of tuning has to be changed because I haven't spoken Tibetan for some time, but I love being with Tibetan people, and above all, Jikten ki shimso ki khalak bobore. Thank you very much. Jai Bharat, Jai Tibet.
Thank you.